The Make in India Paradigm Roadmap for a Future Ready Naval Force International Seminar. I request you to please take your seats, and a polite reminder to all of you to kindly keep your mobile phones in the silent mode. Ladies and gentlemen, we're about to start with the session 7 of the seminar on submarine technologies, and we have our esteemed speakers and our chair for the session amongst us. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm now going to take the privilege of inviting onto the dais our chair for this session, Vice Admiral Arun Kumar Singh, retired. Please welcome him with a big round of applause. Warm welcome, sir. Thank you very much for taking the time out and joining us. And ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to take the opportunity of introducing him briefly before we go ahead. Vice Admiral Arun Kumar Singh, retired, in his distinguished service has served as the Assistant Chief of Naval Staff Submarines, Flag Officer Submarines, and Flag Officer Commanding Eastern Fleet. As a Vice Admiral, he was appointed Director General Indian Coast Guard, Flag Officer Commanding in Chief Andaman and Nicobar Command, and Flag Officer Commanding in Chief Eastern Naval Command. He was trained in the former USSR on nuclear submarines and missiles and as the Assistant Chief of Naval Staff Submarines, he had appeared before a Parliamentary Defense Committee in 1998 and also authored the 30-year submarine building plan approved by the government in 1999. In 2005, as Director General Indian Coast Guard, he appeared before a Parliamentary Defense Committee and initiated the Indian Coast Guard Force Augmentation Plan, which was approved by the government in 2009. And post-retirement, he worked in the private sector of Indian shipbuilding industry, and he's also participated in the Track 2 discussions for 4 years. A very warm welcome to you once again, sir. With that, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to take the opportunity to invite our esteemed speakers on the dais, and may I start by inviting Rear Admiral Mohit Gupta, Assistant Chief of Naval Staff, Submarine, Indian Navy. Please welcome him with a big hand. May I invite Commodore Mukesh Bharga, retired Vice President and Head Larsen & Toubro. Please welcome him with a big hand. Welcome, sir. May I invite Dr. M. Patri, Associate Director, Scientist G, Naval Materials Research Laboratory. Let's welcome him with a big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Commodore Anil J. Singh, retired, Senior Vice President, Atlas Electronic India Private Limited. Please welcome Commodore Anil J. Singh. And we also have with us as our speaker, Mr. Andreas Grunicke, Head of Project Design Operating Unit Submarines. Let's welcome him with a big hand. Warm welcome, sir.
Morning, sir.
So, ladies and gentlemen, our esteemed panelists, our chair on the dais now, and I'm going to request our session chair, Vice Admiral A.K. Singh, to kindly take over the proceedings. Thank you, sir.
Good morning. I thank Tiki for inviting me and for the excellent arrangements made. Time is short, so I shall start without much ado. As a preamble, I would like to mention a few things. One thing which came out very clearly yesterday in the first seminar by Vice Admiral Chopra, we must ensure, this panel discussion should ensure looking at two things. One is affordability and one is our future requirements. This is vital, and indeed in the 10 years that I served in Naval Headquarters, we always looked at affordability versus numbers. If you don't do that, you'll end up like the Air Force did with the Rafael. You all wanted 126, and then the government said, if it's too costly, you get 36. So we numbers have a quality of their own, so we must look at what is affordable. I'll give you a couple of classic examples here. When you know, the Australian submarine project, in which I think the Germans and the Japanese and all are trying to rush headlong into, for 12 submarines. I think it cost something like $2 to $2.5 billion per submarine, and which is exactly the cost of a nuclear submarine, SSM. And on top of it, the Japanese have come up with a new thing. I got it on Twitter yesterday, or day before yesterday. Soryu-class submarine number 11 will have lithium-ion batteries, which will cost $600 million per set. Now, I just checked up in the morning from ACNS submarines. I believe our German submarines, the lead-acid batteries cost about $3 million and they're made in India. So just keep in mind what you want and what our finances are. And also keep in mind the future Navy. And I was part of the 30-year submarine building plan, which is running well behind schedule. But at that time, I remember we were looking at submarines, and our material branch is very keen that whatever we buy should be proven, tested, etc. And I suspect that's why the Scorpion deal was signed only when the Chileans finally took hold of one of their submarines, because there was a big worry that this thing may not float, move and fight. Only thing is, when you, after that, you take another 12, 15 years to build your first Scorpion, the technology is already obsolete. So keep that in mind, some kind of, I'm requesting our panelists to keep this in mind as to what they, which way they want to go ahead in their discussions. In 1998, part of the 30-year submarine plan, I had said one MDL was to build one submarine line, and the second submarine line was to build in a second alternate line, which on file we said It appears to be only L&T. So, and then I did ask the ATV people, would you like to come in? So Admiral Bhushan, who was the head of ATV, he said, we got a handful, but we'll look at it. So the ministries, for the first time ever, sent a MDL L&T team under me as ACNS submarine. We went to Russia to look at Project 75Y. Commodore Lali Sachdev was from MDL, and I think Lieutenant Commander Nigam was from L&T. Well, I guess the good part of it was that these two yards were talking to each other and having a drink together. They were not fighting there. So it was not so bad as one as I was worried about. So there are a couple of other things I would like to mention. There's AIPS being discussed now. In that time when I was making this thing, AIPS was not a proven technology. The Germans had come up with the fuel cell. The French were looking at BESMA and the Stirling engine, but we knew very little about it. So that's why in the first phase, which was the first six submarines, we did not insist on AIPS. We were not sure as to whether it would meet our requirements or they were just bluffing. Especially our material branch was very, very worried that it's a lemon and it may not function. But in the today we do know that AIPS is there. The Naval Headquarters has decided to go for AIPS. I'm glad they've decided to move for AIPS. And there are again areas where we've got Dr. Patri who will be speaking on it. So I hope our own AIPS sees the light of day. I had appeared, it's not only the future Navy. When you modernize submarines, you look at 20 years ahead. Will the submarine look at, meet the challenges of 10 or 20 years from now? So in my time, we modernized the Sishumar class and the Kilo class. And I remember we must have faith in our own people. I'll give you an example. When Sishumar was being modernized and we wanted to reduce the noise level, so some machinery, I think rotary converters were being replaced with static converters and a few other things were being done. And the weight of the submarine went up slightly because we had to put flank array for, to do some silencing. And then, the weight went beyond the permissible limits. I remember Commander P.K. Chatterjee, who recently retired as SINCAN. He was a commander then. He said, sir, simple, let's remove 4 tons of fuel and 2 tons of fresh water. And you compensate the 6 tons. Well, the entire material branch went up in arms. Files went up and down saying, buddy, we got to get the Germans to tell us what to do. So the Germans came, noted our request, and after 2 months came, they said, you know, we recommend carry 4 tons of water less and 2 tons of fuel less. There were some other examples, but they were from the ATV project. I will not like to discuss that here. So we must have faith in our own people. Today Rear Admiral Raj Shekhar is sitting in front of me. He was my Lieutenant Commander or Lieutenant in, when I was ACNS submarine. He came up with this idea of improving the air conditioning of the Kilo class. I took it up. The first hurdle was the material branch. Then the second hurdle was that you can't do it. At the end of the day, well, let me tell you, there were a couple of hiccups. I think you doubled or tripled the air conditioning capability of the Kilo class. And, now that he is there at flag rank, I hope you continue the good work. So, with that little preamble, I would like to introduce the first speaker. First, I'll go speaker by speaker. The organizers have given me a bell. So, when your time is up, I'll ring the bell and I'll request the speaker to kindly wind up as soon as possible after that. The first speaker will have 10 minutes and he happens to be Admiral Mohit Gupta, whom I know very, very well, ACNS submarines, had a distinguished career, 3 commands of Sishumar class, 1 command of a guided missile frigate, Comcos, where CO Vajrabau did the staff college, I think, in South Africa. I've never been to South Africa. I believe it's a lovely place. And then, more than that, in 2004 or 5, the Naval Headquarters, in their wisdom, felt that our submarine commanding officers' qualifying course is not good enough. We have to learn from NATO. So, I was called and I told the CNS, we have taken the best of the British, the best of the Germans, and the best of the Russians, and added our 20% Indian potpourri to it. It's the best. But we were told, no, So Commander Mohit Gupta, who had commanded a sub, finished, I think, 2-3 command, was sent for the NATO course in Holland. He did the course, came back, and he said that our course is still the best. So, and I remember meeting him at DG Coast Guard then, and I was very glad that we had sent a very professional officer to just ratify that we are on the right lines. So Mohit, I'll request you to lay the guidelines for float, move and dive, or float, move and fight. And thereafter, the rest of the panelists would perhaps take the cue from what Naval Headquarters wants. Thank you.
Admiral A.K. Singh, distinguished Vets, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to first of all thank the Chair and FICCI for allowing me to present Indian Navy's perspective on submarine technologies in this session. Indian Navy took her maiden dive with commissioning of our first submarine, INS Kalvari, on 8 December 1967, which was a Foxtrot class submarine acquired from the erstwhile Soviet Union. In this journey close to 5 decades, we have gained valuable expertise and experience in the field of submarines, having operated 8 Foxtrot class submarines, all of which have now been decommissioned. As also a nuclear submarine of the Charlie class, which was acquired on lease from the erstwhile Soviet Union, which also has been returned. We presently operate 10 kilo class submarines, all of which were acquired from the erstwhile Soviet Union, or the Russian Federation, as we call it today, and 4 Type 209 submarines, 2 of which were procured from Germany outright, and 2 were built at Mazagon Dock Limited with assistance from that time HW. We also operate a Dakula class SSN, which is presently on lease from Russia. Shortly, we shall also be inducting the Scorpion class submarines, 6 of which are presently under construction at Mazagon Dock Limited. These submarines would be followed by 6 more submarines, which would be under Project 75 India, and would be the state-of-art conventional submarines with air-independent propulsion and a large array of weapons, as was mentioned by Admiral A.K. Singh. We plan to build the submarines indigenously at an identified Indian yard in collaboration with suitable foreign partners. We have made significant progress in the field of development of submarine technologies in the country, but we need to carry this progress further by expanding the range and depth of this expertise. We in the Indian Navy are keenly looking for indigenously designed submarines built in India with equipment, weapons and sensors required which are comparable to the very best in the world. We also look forward to Indian stakeholders providing us through-life support in maintaining and periodically upgrading the capabilities of these platforms so that we can operate them optimally. The essence of submarines in their capability to be stealthy and avoid detection from adversaries, surveillance means, and deliver the intended punch by packing in mobility, endurance, flexibility of payloads, etc. This requires a complex amalgamation of cutting-edge technologies across the float and dive components, as we would call it in the submarine parlance, the move and fight components in the context of submarines. Firstly, I shall start with the float and the dive components. Ladies and gentlemen, behold, as we dive to take a better look as to what we need. We look forward to development of expertise and design in advanced submarines, as well as indigenous development of high yield strength materials, metallic as well as composites, which can provide platforms which can dive deeper, are prone to lesser corrosion, are easier to build, and have excellent shock absorption properties besides other attributes. There is also a critical requirement to develop stealth technologies which cover smart design and advanced coatings that reduce aerodynamic drag and consequently the radiated noise levels of the platform and improve its stealth. Anechoic tiles that provide both muffling of self-noise and reduction in the reflected returns by absorbing incident sound waves from active sonars are also essential to reduce both the radiated noise level as well as effective acoustic cross-section. In order to prevent detection by sensors employing magnetic anomaly detection techniques, we need materials and technologies that significantly reduce both the acquired and the induced magnetism of the platform. As the capability of the adversary to detect the submarine using other physical fields increases, we also look forward to solutions to counter these and retain the winning edge. Coming to the move component, we need propulsion technologies that are efficient, reliable, and safe, with aggregates that generate minimum noise and need minimum maintenance. Development of highly efficient turbo-supercharged diesel engines that can perform well under high back pressure. Advanced submarine propulsion motors like the permanent magnet synchronous motors. High capacity, high electrical efficiency batteries with high power to weight and high power to volume ratios with long life like the lithium-ion batteries. Advanced air-independent propulsion systems incorporating high efficiency. Development of alternative propulsion techniques such as pump jet is therefore the need of the hour. Coming to the crucial fight component, by which I mean the combat payloads, or simply put, the weapons and sensors, we need advanced low probability of intercept navigational radars, periscopes with high resolution, night vision, low light, thermal imaging, and such other features. We need sonar suites incorporating multiple arrays distributed across the platform hull as well as deployed from the platform that provide both broadband and narrowband detection, classification, tracking, and advanced correlation algorithms. As far as weapons and self-protection suites are concerned, there is a need for development of long-range, high-speed, high-endurance, multi-influence torpedoes that can detect targets at longer ranges and can outsmart the material and tactical countermeasures employed by the adversaries. We also need new generation anti-ship and land attack missiles which can provide longer ranges, precise targeting and effective payloads with features to defeat the anti-missile defenses and other measures employed by the adversaries. Another key challenge is the ability to integrate all payloads on board and make them talk to each other as well as other network assets seamlessly to realize the full potential of the platform as well as other cooperating assets in this network environment. This calls for development of sound communication techniques which provide communication and networking capabilities to submarines using multiple frequencies in all regimes of operation. The wish list, gentlemen, is endless. But a common theme that we want all of these at affordable prices, in compressed time frames, and at times when they are contemporary in the world market. I hope this session would sincerely address these challenges and chart out strategies to achieve the desired goals of the Indian Navy. Jai Hind.
Thank you. Thank you, Admiral. You have rightly set the tone for today's talks by the other speakers. I would like to highlight one or two points here. You have mentioned better steel and stealth and survival against shocks, explosion shocks. You have mentioned Permission motor and pump jet. I'll be covering this in my own talk on nuclear submarines, but pump jet propulsion technology is something we have to look at. In 2010, a British submarine with pump jet technology was hit from behind by a French SSBN, both were SSBNs, and both didn't detect each other. And the French sonar is something like $500 or $600 million, that sonar. It didn't pick up this guy even after he hit him. So that is how silent pump jet technology is. There's no cavitation. All this talk about machinery noise, cavitation noise, hydrodynamic flow noise, etc. Everything changes. Hydrodynamic doesn't change, but with pump jet technology, everything changes, and it's something which we have to look at. And I think he's absolutely covered the fight part of it, and I hope somebody will be covering these. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce the next speaker, Commodore Mukesh Bhargav, who is the Vice President and Head Special Projects in Engineering Systems and Defense and Aerospace at Larsen & Toubro. He and I go back a long way. We were stuck in a place called Vladivostok for 30 months. We went through three winters, temperatures fell to minus 32, and being good Indians, you know, we shivered a lot. We did 30 months of nuclear submarine training together, out of which both of us must have done about 180 days at sea, dived in a nuclear submarine. He was trained to be the radiation safety officer. And I am very glad that in India, at least, Larsen & Toubro had the foresight to select somebody as him on their team. They had the foresight to, but I think they picked up a lot of naval people, but he was one of the best and brightest they did. And I think he would be speaking on future submarine vessel design and materials. Over to you, Mukesh. All the best.
At the outset, I would like to thank the chair, Vice Admiral A.K. Singh, and for him to reminisce about those shivering days at Vladivostok and the time that we spent together. That's not the only one. I think in the Navy also, we have had a number of tenures where we have interacted with each other. Thank you very much, sir, for the kind introduction. I would also like to thank FICCI and the Indian Navy for organizing this seminar, which is so apt at a time when the Navy is looking at acquiring new technologies, especially in the field of the submarine segment, where I think a lot is happening all over the world. Thanks to Admiral Mohit Gupta in his submarines, who has laid out the requirement of the Navy. Quite a lot of it is known, but some of the challenges that he has mentioned are definitely something that the industry and the country need to look at how we're going to take that forward. In the next 15 minutes or so, what I would like to cover is the submarine design and construction. What are the challenges? What are the global trends? What L&T in this country has been able to acquire? And where do we go from here? How do we make a completely indigenous design and developed submarine which meets the aspiration of Admiral Mohit Gupta? So this is the broad scope in which I'll be covering it. Admiral Suresh Mehta is not here, but he's going to be probably here in the evening session. This is what he mentioned when he was the Chief of the Naval Staff as part of the Indian Maritime Strategy. The emphasis would be on force multiplier, quality of weapon sensors, and networking of platforms, something that Admiral Gupta also elucidated. In other words, focus would be on critical capabilities than the number of ships, submarines, and aircrafts. Because you can get force multipliers which can do the job of more than one platform if it is meeting the aspirations. Now, submarine construction, design and construction is a very unique and a special skill, something which is very scarce and sparsely available all over the world. Highly complex, labor, capital, and time intensive. It uses special processes and advanced technologies. So this is what makes submarine construction quite different than even a warship construction, which itself is a very complicated field. If I would like to say, having been on all sides of the submarine, right from design to construction to operations, and now heading the business as well, constructing a submarine is like building a ship inside a bottle. You must have seen those souvenirs that you get. You have all the outfitting going to be done after the hull is already ready. So you have to virtually go inside like a glass bottle and fit it out. As the fitting out progresses, the opening and spaces keeps getting constrained. which not only hampers the progress, it makes even the existing outfitting challenging, and God forbid if you have to do a rework. Very limited option due to the complexity of the design. Sequencing of the activity is one of the crucial aspects of coming, making a submarine come out in time, and the supply chain management, because that is what is going to govern the actual cycle time of construction and design of a submarine. Unique design engineering skills are needed, the knowledge pool and experience, whatever limited we have in the country, whether in the public or the private sector, needs to be nurtured, sustained and promoted. Now let's look at what is happening globally as far as the submarine order book is concerned. Worldwide, not just because of the economic slowdown, but also because of the various peace initiatives, there is a decline in the order book. Less and less programs one hears of. Admiral A.K. Singh mentioned about the Australian program. We have, I think, the maximum programs either in the pipeline or coming out, which is happening. As the operational life of the submarine increases, the technology takes a leap. And if you are taking a submarine which designed or conceived in the 2000, by the time it comes out in 2010, two generations of technologies would have moved. Budgets are getting very, very strained. Even the expertise that exists, it becomes difficult to maintain, because there's a huge gap between the programs. In our own country, after the SSK program, we had the Scorpion program, and after the Scorpion program, we are already 16 years down the line, and 75 India, as Admiral Mohit mentioned, is yet to happen. So that makes the process very complex, and even to take a well-informed decision by the decision makers as well as the industries for where to invest becomes difficult. As far as leveraging the benefits are concerned, also becomes difficult because of the challenges that are faced. And whatever has happened in the past programs, you can't take those learnings into the next because of the gap in the programs. Skill sets gets eroded, expertise gets diluted, and ultimately the country gets landed as what we would not like to have, as the CNS submarine said, dependencies on the foreign OEMs. Most of the programs as we see today that are going on are having time and cost overruns. Now let's start with the design, and one of the most important aspects is the hull form. Way back, the Type 21 German boats at the end of the World War II were designed basically for operating underwater. So the hull and the profile was based on that. Speeds were of the order of 5, maximum going to 18 knots, and then evolved the albacore hull, where you could achieve, because of the hydrodynamic teardrop shape, a speed which could go in excess of 30 knots, and various upgrades in the various equipment fit. When we look at the design challenges, everybody has a recipe which is the best in class, and it should facilitate a variety of design and production techniques. You want the submarine, as ACN has mentioned, in the shortest possible time at the least cost. This leads to major design challenges in designing a submarine. The principal objective is that we follow a zone-wise construction approach. We capture the database in the digital format so that it is easy to use and spread across the entire spectrum, and provide a total digital solution which would be able to help the submarine come out in the time that the customer wants. And the logistics support as far as possible to facilitate the construction effort. Stealth, as ACN has mentioned, power density, the power to weight and power to volume ratios, propulsion plant efficiencies. Now there are submarines which are coming out, especially in the nuclear field, where you don't have to do refueling at all. I think Admiral Anand Kumar mentioned it yesterday. And the continuous drive in new methodologies like AIP, I think Mr. Patri would be speaking about it. So sequestration of funds, whatever limited resources are available, implies that the future submarine design would need to have a design of a submarine which can do multi-task and multi-functions, so that you can do much more with much less. As far as the hull materials are concerned, submarines, because of the basic purpose of the pressure hull, which need to withstand a very corrosive environment and at depths, it has to be a high strength, low alloy steel. And some of the examples are mentioned over here. Russians have made few submarines hulls using the titanium also, which has able to achieve greater than 40 knot speed and could also go to depths which it can avoid all the sensors. Now, comparing the various features of the various submarine programs across the world, I have taken the examples of 3-4 developed nations who are making the submarines and what are the features that are available there, which can probably be a basis of us to take up what we need to have it in future. The Virginia class, the deck structure is absolutely modulated with isolation. The command center is one single unit resisting on a cushion mounting points. Steering and diving control, just like your the PlayStation, is a 2-axis joystick. Low acoustic signature, anechoic coating, deck structure, and design of the propulsor to make the acoustic signature low. HF acoustic arrays located on the sail, also to look at shallow water operations. And making the sonar domes composite material, which will not only give the strength, but also reduce the weight and give you the acoustic opaqueness that you need. The command centers, open architecture, plug and play, 16 SLCMs launched from a single salvo, 26 heavyweight torpedoes. It can operate SEALs, which is the commando's operation, full spectrum of radar processing, the sensors, photonic mask rather than a photonic mask, and long-term mine reconnaissance systems. Lightweight, wide aperture radar systems for fiber optic array instead of ceramic hydrophone sensors. These are some of the technologies being used on the Virginia class. If you look at the Astute from British, one of the world's most sophisticated and powerful nuclear submarine, as it's been cited, carries dozens of cruise missiles hitting range of more than 1,000 miles away. Sonar can detect vessels on the other side of Atlantic Ocean. This is the kind of capability today available. As I mentioned, the reactor can operate non-stop for 25 years, and the Ambush class does not even have a periscope. If you look at our friends, the Russian, the K-560 Sverdlovsk, this is using a little departure from the existing practice of a double hull submarine, and they are having a hybrid design with lighter structures over the vessel's pressure hull. They are also having a spherical bow sonar, and the torpedo tubes are located somewhere around the midships rather than in the bow section. 8 torpedoes, 4 lightweight, 4 heavyweights, and can suggest it can carry up to 30 torpedoes. 24 missile launching tubes with more than 200 nautical miles. Also carry various advanced missile systems, more than 1,600 nautical miles. Subsonic land attack capability. Some of them we are looking at, and some of them we are already using. Anti-submarine missiles, mine laying, anti-torpedo defense, and even an anti-air capability. The Barracuda, range of diving and sifting damage control technologies and an IPMS, range of stealth technologies to minimize the various signatures. It can also be configured to launch UUVs, unmanned underwater vehicles, and nuclear propulsion is a hybrid design. Looking at the various design practices, I have selected 4 major countries who are our areas of interest as well as who are the world leaders. If you look at the US and France, there are a lot of similarities in the method that is being used, 3D modeling, highly automated and de-skilled workers, use of connectors, cables, connectors for cables, high degree of laser metrology, and no hydro pressure test. The Germans differ in that they follow a 1:5 scale solid model for actual production, and the drawings are extracted or the guidance is taken from this model, and a lot of similarity between US, France and Germany. Russia, on the other hand, has followed a different concept. They use templates for pipe fabrication, and a lot of support comes from the designers at the time of execution. The HPT, hydro pressure test, is a unique concept that the Russians follow for the outfitting, and now they are also moving towards a 3D AutoCAD and modular construction design. Now, looking at these global practices and the global systems which are there, How is India, our own country, poised towards taking the submarine design forward? In Larsen and Toubro, we look at it as a complete design solution, complete digital design solution. I tried to take what is available on the media. This slide may not be accurate, and this is a declaration I want to make upfront. This is from the published information what is available. The various capabilities that a digital mock-up would give, and how the various other countries are facing. In the case of Russia, we don't have much published information, so most of it is not available, but some of them which are partially available. Small bore piping, less than 20 MB. Every individual cable getting mapped, even the fasteners and technical attributes getting mapped, the complete inventory, the bill of material getting generated out of the digital model, and the use of virtual reality for finalizing the layout, modular design for layout optimizations. These are some of the capabilities that we have developed it in-house within the country, which as you can see are not only best in the world, but maybe even better. Now, how do we go about executing this kind of a solution? It starts from the system schematics, which are there for all the systems. We have a 3D CATIA V5 software and a VPLM, Virtual Project Lifecycle Management, and a PLM system. From this, we drive out the 3D schematic-driven modeling and auto cable routing. Every single cable is having its unique identity and is routed individually. The modeling is done based on certain rules, which I'll show it in the next slide. And the isometrics are generated from where the pipes, the entire isometric can go to the pipe shop and the pipe comes out from there. With this, the two other capabilities that we have developed is with a virtual reality, where the kinematics, the various kind of parameters that are required, the walkthrough, digital walkthrough through a virtual ship can be done, interface checks, the shipping in routes can be finalized, the analysis for finite element analysis and interference analysis, and also sequencing, which I mentioned, is one of the key towards making an effective submarine within the required time. We have the ERP system BAN and a project management software Concerto, and with these, we are able to get output which is in terms of design of the complex jigs and fixtures, the various production drawing which goes straight to the shipyard for execution, the bill of material, the shipping and out routes. A lot of customization has been done on the submarine design and construction technology applications, which are from the concept design to taking the library of the entire equipment which are there, which are modeled. We have the structural modeling being done. We have the schematic generation also being done from for the pipe schematics and the outfitting modeling done from this software. The layout checks for any interference and for the operability, maintainability, and replacement, rule-based design. Reviews of the design can be done through a virtual reality software. And finally, the production drawing, which goes out from this 3D environment straight to the ship, where to the shipyard, where it is in a virtually paperless model. Okay, I'll move a little fast. Equipment library, the soft spaces that you see, this is a unique thing that only we are doing it. I didn't find any published literature where this is being followed, which also models the maintenance and operation spaces. All parts related attributes and soft spaces are generated. We take a scanned, laser scanned image of the equipment as it is being developed. This is one of the major challenges because the binding data that you get at the time of the design and the equipment when it comes, you find huge mismatches. These can be overcome by having an equipment library. The various digital modeling for structures, piping, equipment, cabling. This is the kind of layout of a compartment which would look like for piping and likewise for the cabling and also for the structures. With this, the whole host of capabilities that come out from a digital model are shown on the slide. Right from the nesting plan to the as-built drawings, everything can be taken out from this digital model. We have a full kit 3D model, which in the design office, when it is finalized, is sent to the shipyard, and it contains all these that have been mentioned. The various operability, maintainability, and accessibility checks have been done. The man-machine interface are done so that all interferences are removed at the design stage so that you don't have any rework. And almost 80% model gets complete even before you start cutting the steel. The piping isometrics are taken out from the 3D model. The cable routing, which is, I said, is a unique feature, with features like bend radius validation, hanger size validation, and even the cable length. These are all in-house designed capabilities. Rule-based design, which takes the various normatives imbibed into the software as what should be the total pipe length, bend radius, uniformity of bend in pipe, and other things. This is another unique feature that we have been able to generate, which is reducing the execution of the work, where you first find out what are the weld points required in terms of pipe support, cable hangers, and minor foundations. You do these weldings, do the complete painting, get the compartment ready, and then go ahead and do the piping and cabling, which reduces the rework, which earlier in the method was doing extensively. Total about 2 million odd units are required for one model, which are as mentioned, and the digital walkthrough, 3D virtual reality, it's not only for us designers, but also for the customer who can come and see, look and feel how the submarine would look like, give us suggestions which can get incorporated, and we can improve the design even before we go for first cut. The 3D virtual reality, the various possibilities, life cycle support as ACNS mentioned, requirement capture, design reviews, all this can be done, even technical deployment and mission rehearsal can be done in a 3D environment. The virtual reality setup which we have, it's a 3D immersive visualization. So I'll just come to the last slide. Some of the innovations that have been done, which has helped the construction of the submarine to be done in almost not zero defect or zero fault, but almost there. Laser coordinate measuring machine, linear distance, laser managed scanners, cross liners for faster, accurate, and repeatability work. Technologies which are used on the, we don't use RT films hard at all. It's completely digitized. And on the shop floor, there's no paper. It's only a digital display which the worker goes and refers to. In process inspection, we have a Wi-Fi handheld devices which speeds up the process much faster. And various welding automation, we are probably one of the best welders in the world, so we have used that, including robotics, which has brought huge time and cost saving in the whole affair. The various technologies for manufacturing of the pressure hull, the launching option, using the pontoon as is being done in the case of SSK, Skorkin. Also for the USS Texas, which is using a floating dry dock. We have a floating dry dock in our shipyard at Kattupalli. And also, sorry, a ship lift in Kattupalli, we are using the ship lift. You can see INS Jyoti over here. And finally, the typical build strategy in terms of fabrication of structural block, outfitting the blocks individually, and then closed blocks joining and launching the submarines. The various technology spectrum continuously evolving, newer and newer technologies are getting added, and this is an ongoing process. The last slide, gentlemen, I'd like to spend 2 minutes on that. Ladies and gentlemen, Indian taxpayers have repeatedly paid for submarine design and construction. We have had three times, once with the SSK, then with the Russians, not so much, but again now with the French. However, we are still not in position to have the assimilation of all this knowledge base. Where does it reside in the country? We need to see that all that the taxpayer money has been spent, it should be consolidated in one place, so that tomorrow we can meet the requirement of Admiral Mohit Gupta and embark upon a completely indigenous submarine design by ourselves. So there is a need to synergize and assimilate this knowledge pool, and this has already been mandated in the CCS approved 30-year submarine building plan. L&T, with almost nil transfer of technology, has developed and acquired design and construction capability, innovations done in-house, which I have shown in the previous slide, and build these telecom platforms of high quality in a reasonable time, and has demonstrated credible progress on the follow-ons. This capability needs to be leveraged by the government and nurture and sustain, and strategic partnership could be one of the models that can be followed. Industry is capable and willing, ready to enhance self-reliance in this complex field, and the next generation submarine would be indigenously designed and developed with whatever little help from the foreign OEM. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
You've taken 25 minutes. Oh, thank you, Mukesh, for a 25-minute talk. but it was very informative, there's no doubt about it. I think you covered most aspects of it, but I would just like to... Mr. Anders, I'll take a minute to introduce you, please. I just wanted to say that a couple of things which need to be kept in mind. One is submarines are very, very weight sensitive. So you can have any amount of computers. Saw what the Spanish did. They had the best computers. They had Lockheed Martin helping them from America. And they made an error of one decimal in the weight calculations. And they're losing 5 years now in trying to increase the reserve buoyancy, the compartments by about 5 or 10%, or 6 meters, I think it was. Secondly, every submarine must have about 4 to 5% space for future growth. The future sensors may come in. You mentioned a few other things like titanium, etc. I will cover it in my own nuclear submarine talk. Hull thickness is very important. When I went to France, I've been to all the shipyards in Germany, France, Russia, etc. In France, when they showed me the SSBN under construction, that was the 1997, the bow side, the HLES steel was 300 millimeters thick. And the missile silos compartment was 300 millimeters thick. So that requires some kind of bending, some kind of machinery to, and some kind of welding. And finally, a word on, you can have any amount of computers, it depends what you feed into it. You'll end up with the wrong pipeline lens, and then you waste another 6 years, which some of us did somewhere. And you must look at how the Russians built a kilo-class submarine in 27 months. Please go and see it. Cut the compartments and just push in the pre-assembled items. And in 27 months, plant a 3,000-ton submarine goes for sea trials. Okay, it's now my pleasure to invite Mr. Andrei Grunuke. He's the head of project design, operating unit submarines. He's from ThyssenKrupp Marine Systems. I have been to Germany as a world leader in submarine building. And just as I might mention, I think Mukesh mentioned a Type 21 submarine. When you go to Kiel, I think on the beach, they mounted a Second World War submarine. It's worthwhile going there and taking a look. It's exactly like the Foxtrot class submarine we had, except that we had three sharp proper shafts and propellers. These guys had two. And more importantly, you see the DK2 diesel compressor there. The Germans were using the same compressor in the Second World War, which we had in our Foxtrot class submarines 20, 30 years later. So over to Mr. Andrei Grunuke. All the best.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, admirals, officers, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, it's a pleasure to give a short presentation about technology development by ThyssenKrupp Marine Systems. Thank you. The content of my presentation is structured as follows: a short introduction, some information about lithium-ion batteries, fuel cell methanol reformer systems, IDAS missile system, UV integration concept, some topics regarding hydrodynamic propeller development activities, acoustic coating, and a summary. But before I start the presentation, a short statement from German submarine division. Also, we are now doing 100% cut modeling for our projects. So also the world of 1-to-5 scale plastic model is over, and also we are now in a digital model version. Some words about our company. ThyssenKrupp is divided into business areas. So you can see component technologies, elevator technologies, industrial solutions. So the submarine business is part of industrial solutions. And the business unit of marine systems is divided into operating units. So there's an operating unit submarines, which is located in Kiel, known as in the past as HW, now on a TKMS. And there are other operating units like surface vessel in Hamburg and Emden and services, which are responsible for all the after-sales activities, which are located in Kiel, Hamburg, and Emden. Some words about the general task of research and development. So there are two topics. This is to be in the position of a technology leadership and also a cost leadership. And therefore, we like to get the enhancement of customer value, cost reduction, and risk reduction. The scope of research and development activities is in principle divided into three fields. These are products, and products in our definition are submarines. So we are having the in-house product development capability for different submarine types, components and systems, and processes and tools. Here, a short overview about research and development potential we have done during the last years. So at the moment, we are running more than 160 research and development projects on a neutral basis, and there are other research and developments which are linked to project activities. And you can see that most of the activities are belong to the operating unit submarine. Some overview about long-lasting developments. So from first development activities still in service activities, you can see the timeline of development and integration. So here are some figures regarding weapon section, development and integration, torpedo countermeasure, ISIS 90 family, thermosin motor, fuel cell, IDAS, lithium batteries, which is still ongoing project, and also some product like class 212 and class 14. Starting with the first technology. Lithium-ion battery is now coming more and more as a topic, so we are also, since many years, involved in this field. Here, just a short overview about the Ragone diagram. So the motivation is to extend the time submerged, to increase the speed spectrum while submerged, and decrease the integration rate, increase the availability of the system, and decoupling submarine performance from battery characteristics as much as possible. And last but not least, extend the lifetime. So we are at the moment in the range of telling that the lifetime of these batteries will be in the range of 10 years plus. Some technical concepts about performance. You can see here two different curves based on lithium-ion, which will come with a discharge capability of 93% and lead-acid battery, which is covered 80%. The most interesting thing is under high load condition. And in this, you can see here, in this field, we are talking about the performance improvement of more than 200%. This is the most interesting part, which is an interesting combination between fuel cell-based AP and this kind of capability. Table 2 shows some comparison regarding charging time. You can see on one side the loading procedure to do for lead-acid batteries, on the other hand for lithium-ion batteries. And the benefit is that you can shorten the charging time based on the same performance level with a reduction of more than 28%, because all this can be done in the charging step 1 instead of doing this in charging step 1 and 2 as required for lead-acid batteries. The major integration aspects are system safety, and this is one of the topics. So we have investigated different kind of battery cell types. So you can see the nickel-cobalt-aluminum, nickel-magnesium-cobalt, and nickel-cobalt-oxide. And there are other some triggers like overcharge, overload, overheat, mechanical damage, and internal short. And the decision based on these technology is now in our company to go to a safe chemistry which is based on lithium iron phosphor. And this is one of the most topics to get a safe high energy system on board of the submarine. So the decision was to select a well-established cell manufacturer with system development competency. So we've done also some studies to develop this specific high energy cells, but the final decision was to go to a standard cell type as written here, and select a safe cell chemistry. The focus, which is done by our company, is the integration aspect, how to do the integration of these cells in our submarines. Here, just an example, some rough figures how to do so. So you can see the general data of high-energy battery. So we can, one of the interesting things is the number of cells. So we're talking then about more than 100,000 standard cells we have to integrate in such a high-energy battery. Coming to the next topic. For commercial submarine, it's a classic arrangement based on diesel generator battery technology, which can be seen here. The 214 class is an integrated AUP submarine with integrated fuel cell, O2 and H2 storage cylinder. The idea is now for higher requirements coming from customers to do producing of H2 on board of the submarine by using reformatic technology. Just a simple overview with, to show the break even. There's a benefit in high or higher AOP energy storage requirements that the weight volume capability is not balanced. So therefore, I think for higher AOP requirements for longer, for more than 2 weeks and so on, we will go as a decision then more to a methanol reformer system instead of H2 storage cylinder. The generation by using methanol based on steam reforming is simple. So we're using methanol. Methanol is coming with the lowest reforming temperature. It's cheap and easy, available worldwide, like liquid oxygen, and methanol steam reforming is a proven technology in the process industry. So therefore, it's the best choice to do generation of H2 on board of submarines. The fuel cell reformer system, so we've done we've built a first demonstrator and now going to the next step to build a real, based on submarine requirement based reformer system, which can be seen here. So we also can see here the shape of the pressure hull. So this is installed at our test facility, and since 2015 we are also producing methanol based on these submarine based methanol reformer. Coming to the next topic, IDAS. IDAS is, from our side, an answer to get also capability in a metric threat scenario. So one of the topics at the beginning was to get active self-defense capability against helicopters, and also to get a high precision through human-in-the-loop concept, and also the idea to get a coastal and small surface target tech capability. The IDAS consortium is organized under the cooperation of four companies. These are ThyssenKrupp, Diehl, Nammo from Norway, and Rokossan from Turkey. Here are some ideas for the IDAS target spectrum. So we are talking about the defensive role and the offensive role. These are some ideas how to use the IDAS system. The integration of this system is based on the idea to use the same dimension as a heavyweight torpedo. So we are using a start container, which can be seen here, during loading procedure on board of a German 212 submarine. So we can use the same loading infrastructure as used also for missile and heavyweight torpedoes. The integration, the system will be integrated as an integrated version, not as a standalone. And the technical concept for the start container is that such a start container can integrate four of these IDAS missiles, all launching subsystem on the container, so it's complete autonomous. And the weight dimension compared to a heavyweight torpedo, so that will be easily refit also for other or in operation submarines. Some data regarding IDAS missile system, so we are talking about a range of roughly 20 kilometers. And these are figures as you can see here. Next topic are unmanned underwater vehicles for port of submarines. So it's also a topic we discussed several times here during our session, that more and more unmanned vehicles will be combined with conventional submarines. So we are also doing some tests how to do integration. The normal idea for AUVs is to bring sensors from surface down to the ocean and close to the target, and away from disturbing noise and vibration. For submarines, is the idea to do the same, to bring sensors from down in the ocean, away from the submarine in areas of very shallow water, and to the surface. How to do integrations? So we've identified different areas to do integration concepts. The idea is to do it in an easy way, and to do integration in a way not to be visible if you're doing this integration. So we identified several areas. One is the area of the casing, where we've developed concepts to do handling and integration of these UAVs, but also to use the weapon tube. This is a concept how to do integration into a weapon tube, similar as we've shown for stock containers, also a containerized version. We've done first tests based on the designed by Diehl or Delvin. So you can see here how to do the integration. We are using the start container. We will eject the container. The UAV will leave the submarine, and recovery will be in the same way. And then we'll take it back. That's the concept in principle, in short words. We've done some tests. So we have our own test facility in our company. And we are now in a way to step to our AV based on the Atlas Elektronik SIG Detmark 1 with some modifications. So it's coming with some other dimensions. So we also adapted the container to show, based on demonstration, the recovery activity. Here you can see the test facility with the platform, so we can easily do installation of this test facility in water. And here, sorry, a short film to show some of these demonstration tests. This is a platform with the installed installation facility. You can see the UAV coming back. The aim of these tests is first to demonstrate the principles, and later on we like also to show the handling of such a procedure on board of a submarine, which will bring maybe additional requirements and risk. So as a first conclusion, we've reached the aim of launch and recovery. We tested the mechanical function, which we demonstrated during these tests. We have shown the drive-in and drive-out processes, and we've also tested the autonomous location maneuvering to recover for the recovery device. The next steps will be that we also like to show these based now on, inside a weapon cube, that we have also to modify these devices to integration of larger UAVs. And as I said, also for the change over to the CCAT system, and then to do this also on trials on submarines. Some other topics regarding developments are modification of propeller design. So we have done some simulation. Also, we are using wind tunnel tests to show the influence. You can see the water flow, which will be influenced by the casing, can be seen here. And one of the ideas and improvements we have done, that we've designed a pre-swell radar configuration, which was first tested on board of the 212 second batch German submarine type. And there we tested also by using real test performance improvements, which will be now the basis for all our submarine types. The other optimization is that we are doing development activities for composite propeller concepts. So here you can see a concept where we are used individual screwed blades, which will be screwed on the sub. And here you can see the composite propeller, which was installed on a 212 German submarine type, which is now running with such a propeller to test the performance. It's not only reduction of weight and to get the chance to get replaceable blades, but also the improvement of resilience, and also during this task we measured major improvements in this field. Acoustic coating, also one topic as discussed during our session here. We are doing in-house development activities regarding acoustic coating types. So in principle, we're talking about two different types, transmission loss coating, an anechoic coating. You can see here the evolution of development coming from design of submarines to, on the left, the classic, then improved version, which is based on 212 and 214. And on the right side, you can maybe see the future. So maybe coating is only the second solution. Maybe in the future, we are talking from the beginning also by using stealth design activities. So these are some future activities. So we are running projects to see from the beginning totally other design as we are using since many, many, many years. Anyhow, these in-house developed coatings now also under contract in some areas. We are now doing development activities also to show the improvements in other fields, but anyhow. For calculation, we are using a standard submarine simulation tool called Betsy. You can see here some calculation based on these theoretical simulation calculation program. And you can see here the detection area reduction by using an uncoated submarine, a coated submarine, and a shaped submarine. Or in detection range, we can also see here the improvement if it's uncoated model, a coated model, or a shaped model. And I think this is one of the topics we have also to see in the future, that from this point of view, from stealth, we have to bring also the improvements to submarines. Here's some more examples about development activities. So all electric ship, energy management, these are also some topics. So we are also in in-house development activities to develop electrical rudder drive, but we are also in the mechanical field, like improved torpedo countermeasure systems for active hard kill and software capability. This ends my high-speed presentation. Thank you very much, and this was just a short way. Thank you very much.